I was actually on my third audition when I met Lara, and then we followed, we kind of went along the same path from there, continuing on to Longcross Studios, which the film is filmed. Amazing. Again, like, finding out that I'd been cast in December was like, you don't believe it at first. And even when you do, you still don't believe it. It's really surreal. Artemis is a really, really smart 12-year-old, and he's part of a criminal dynasty. His task in the film is to find his father, who has been captured, and he uses the fairy world to his advantage to retrieve his father. He really let you use your own creative input. The best thing about Ken was, like, he was an actor before he became a director. So he really knows what it's like to be in your shoes. He's always just giving you really nice hints. Like, you'll do the scene and then you'll do it in lots of different variations, like with just different styles, but not completely overwhelming you with information, just enough to keep you going. My first scene with her is sitting across the table and we're kind of having a standoff. So that was kind of daunting in itself, having that. But to kind of lighten the mood, before I had met up with her for my first day on set with her, and we had baked fairy cupcakes, all of the cast together. Like, that idea brought to life from the books, I always thought the manner was perfect. And it was really useful as well having it, because you were able to see some really nice camera work moving through the rooms, rather than shooting one room, then moving to another set and shooting another room. So you were able to get, especially with the troll scenes, I thought were just perfect for it, with it crashing through the house and just getting all around. It really added to the environment.
So my agent actually contacted me at Disney were casting a new film, and immediately I couldn't believe that I was being asked to audition for a Disney film. And then she mentioned that it was for Artemis Fowl, and I looked over at my bookshelf and there were the 8 books by Uncolfer. And I was a huge fan of the books growing up, so I immediately knew who Holly was, and I was so excited that they were just making this into a film, let alone the fact that I was getting to audition for it. So I auditioned in Dublin and was lucky enough to be asked for a callback. So I went to London, where I met Ferdia for the first time. And I also met Kenneth Branagh, who directs the film, which was a surreal experience within itself. And then after that, I traveled to Longcross Studios, where I did 2 screen tests. And then in December, I found out that I had been offered the role. And when I found that out, I collapsed in tears, is the only way I can describe it, and accused my mother of lying to me, because I genuinely could not fathom the idea that I'd been cast in a Disney film. I play Holly Short, who is an elf police officer, and she is a feisty, determined, passionate, quick-thinking character. She is all in on action, and she will always do what is right, even if she has to disobey orders and maybe turn some heads. She will always do what is fundamentally right at the end of the day. He's an incredible mind. I mean, he's an incredible actor and he's an incredible director. So to get to work with him was just such an amazing experience for both of us. He really made this incredible atmosphere on set where we all felt so comfortable and we all became like a family, the cast and the crew. And definitely in that environment, we felt free to give our creative input and try out new ideas and definitely grow as actors and as people. So it was an amazing experience working with him. I was so nervous to meet her. I couldn't, just because she's such a legend, the legend that is Dame Judi Dench. And then when I met her in person for the first time, I just couldn't believe that she was standing in front of me, and I started to cry. I just couldn't believe she was a real person. She's not only incredibly sweet and funny and just a lovely person, but she is, of course, a phenomenal actor. And getting to do a scene with her was definitely something else. it's so magical to watch all of these things come to life, because of course, as much as the film looks amazing, a lot of the stuff was actually there in real life, believe it or not. And then getting to see the details added in, such as the fact that there is an actual moving troll instead of a stuntman running around on stilts. And it really brings the picture together, I think. Just the details, whether it be the backdrop for Haven City or Holly's wings or something as big as the troll. It really is so surreal to watch something that we could only use our imaginations for come to life on the screen.
I mean, he's the ideal director, isn't he? He's somebody who has actually stepped and lived in my shoes as an actor. So he knows how to so effortlessly communicate what he needs as a director. And so first and foremost, I love that. But I love his sense of wonder. I love his sense of humor. I love this idea that he is such an auteur, while at the same time is so open to fun and play and collaboration. I had gotten the offer quite a few months after I had done Murder on the Orient Express with he and Dame Judi Dench. And I was immediately drawn to the idea of working with Ken again. And I would do it again and again and again, because he's just the ideal filmmaker. But I wanted to really get a feel for the books, which I had never read, frankly. So I opened them up and I was immediately transported to such a unique world written by the brilliant Owen Colfer that involved this criminal 12-year-old mastermind who, in a book populated by so many brilliant adult figures, both in human form and otherwise, is the smartest of them all and manages to outwit them all. And similarly, I was very drawn to this character, Mulch Diggins, who's a loner, who's roguish, who's puckish, who has a lot hidden behind that charm and is very adept at what he does, which is, unfortunately, steal treasures. So I just love this idea of like Hagrid by way of Han Solo. I just thought it was such a fascinating archetype to sink my teeth into. That woman can literally do everything. Like, she is such a playful and brilliant person to interact with. And anything you give her, she'll give you back and more. I mean, she gave me this pillow as a wrap gift, which should tell you everything there is to know about how freaking funny she is. It's basically a cease and desist pillow. So like, I actually think she is so unbelievably effortless at improv. I remember coming up with a whole bunch of very strange names for her. And she, as the Brits say, she corpsed. She started laughing so hard. Ken was probably very annoyed with me because I kept ruining takes by making her try to giggle. I successfully made Dame Judi laugh quite a bit. Action, adventure, magical, full of wonderment and surprise. It is everything that the human soul could need, right? It is a two-hour joyride that will allow for, you know, the great escapism that film and only film can provide.
So obviously auditioned for it, and I think that's the first I'd heard about it. And once I auditioned, I read the book, or I read a part of the book, and I was like, wow, this is really exciting. I originally auditioned for Holly, and I got pretty close, and I think I'd gotten to the point where we had done a screen test, and that screen test I'd met Lara, and I found out that I didn't get the part, but Kenneth Branagh wanted me to be in another part, so that's how I ended up getting Juliet, which was super amazing for me, because it was really inspiring, because he gave me a chance to sort of be in the movie, which was really, really exciting for me. And obviously I found out that Lara had gotten the part, and I was like, wow, she truly deserved it. And honestly, no one could play Holly better than her. I would describe her as strong. Mm-hmm. She knows what she wants. She's level-headed. She is smart, And I think she's also very generous. He was truly a light. He was a light on set. He was absolutely amazing. He was like an uncle to me. He was so lovely, and he was super genuine, and he thought of games to play on set when we were working long days, and we would talk in the makeup trailer while we were getting our hair and makeup done, and we had a stunt sequence in the movie which we got to practice in stunt training for, and that was super exciting. So yeah, he was truly amazing. I am at loss of words thinking about Ken. Ken is such a creative director. He is such an out-of-box director. He thinks of the most crazy ideas for scenes. So he'll say, okay, right, stop, cut. We're going to do the scene again, and I want you to do it in an Irish accent. Oh, we're going to do the scene again, but we're just going to completely ad-lib it. Don't say any of the right lines. And it's just so interesting watching him work and sort of having a gateway to his brain to see how it works. The first time I saw it, it was sort of maybe 3/4 built. So you couldn't really see everything. And I think the second time I saw it was a week before filming, and I went inside, and it was this massive, massive house, and you could see loads of people walking around, and it was really shocking. I was like, wow, wow. I was gobsmacked. Oh yeah, first of all, very intimidating, but she is a really inspiring, generous, wise person, and she's so genuine. And I think my favorite time to spend with her was in makeup and hair trailer, because I'd be in there for about 2 hours and we just talk, and she just taught me so many things. And I think it really humbled me and inspired me, being able to spend time with her. Humbling, fun, and overall life-changing. So Artemis Fowl is based on an amazing book series by Ian Colfer, and it basically follows the journey of Artemis Fowl, whose father, Artemis Fowl Sr., goes missing. And in order to pay his ransom, he has to find the Aculos. And to find the Aculos, he has to discover an underground civilization, the fairy world. Everything you thought you knew has been flipped upside down. Fairies are real, goblins are real, trolls are real. Everything you didn't think was real is real. And he has to steal the most coveted, dangerous fairy device.
I was working with Disney on Cinderella, and we were in post-production, and I just read Artemis Fowl because my nephews had introduced me to it on a holiday. And shortly thereafter, Sean Bailey got in touch and said, would I like to direct it? So I was new to the book, but was excited to kind of, for me, it was initially sort of like a twin project. If Cinderella was in a strange way a kind of coming of age movie for a young woman, it felt like this was a mirrored experience with a young man. So I was very drawn to these two projects as wildly differently expressed versions of the coming of age of young man, young woman. Owen Colfer I met really early on when I joined, and largely it was to agree with him that he was gracious enough to give us his permission to be quite free with our film adaptation, to try and find the ways in which we could perhaps form an origin story that would definitely begin with his first book and the events of his first book, but that also allowed us some chances to borrow a little from the second book and make some things up as well. So what we had was his blessing, sometimes his involvement, but mainly his blessing to run our own creative course. And he popped in and out of the process, visited the set, and then and in fact appears in the movie vocally in an appearance right at the end of our post-production process. He plays a newsreader, an Irish newsreader, that explains very clearly that amazing artifacts have been stolen, possibly by Artemis Fowl Sr. at the beginning of the film. So that's an Easter egg for the fans if they can spot which voice is Owens. Keeping people connected to Artemis's personality as a first-time character in a complex story, and then interweaving the two worlds, the world of Artemis in present-day Ireland in Fowl Manor, and the underground world of Haven City, where the fairies live. And in those two worlds, how often do you go backwards and forwards from one to the other? How could we make sure that the audience were keeping pace with the arrival of all of these different characters, fairies, goblins, trolls, characters from Thirdia's immediate family circle? It was finding a clear way through that, not being too complicated, but being complex enough to keep people's interest. So it was a balance that had to be found. I guess that was the biggest challenge. Lucy Bevan, our casting director, began a search that was worldwide, actually. We knew it was a big ask for a young man, 11, 12 years, to carry a picture, as he had to. Eventually, it was Ireland, really, that we focused on. 1,200 boys in Ireland were seen. And over 9 months, Ferdia maintained a sense of humor about the whole process, which in itself was good evidence of his stamina for making the film. And we knew him to be a passionate enthusiast for the books themselves. He was encyclopedic in his knowledge of the character, and he was open to all our tests of his physical dexterity and his acting performance, his ability to cope with sharing the screen with Judi Dench or Josh Gad or whatever. And generally his assurance, not overconfidence, but his assurance was what marked him up, and that extra humorous, compelling, charismatic quality that has him be such a sort of arresting screen presence. But patience throughout a long, difficult process was a big part of knowing that it was him. We wanted, wherever we could, to surprise people with what we were doing on film. We knew that Root's irascibility as a character, and also great leadership skills and drive, was something that we wanted to keep in the story. That was pure Owen. But a surprise would certainly be provided if you cast Judi Dench as an 840-year-old fairy. She loves surprising the audience, doing parts that she's never done before. And when we asked her to do this, she loved and relished the idea of how very different it was. An Irish accent, pixie ears, green uniform, and the capacity to pilot your own flying machines. She found that irresistible. Well, you know, if you're a commander, you get to go around Haven City on one of those segways. What a late husband used to refer to Judi, rather, he would say, every morning is Christmas morning with Judi. When the segway came on set and she said, can I drive that? Is that me? She couldn't be kept away from it. In fact, I think she still has it. It may have kept her sane in lockdown. And so it was possible to shoot in a way that led inside and outside, connected the two, made you feel a reality, which we felt was very important, an authenticity, which was super necessary in a movie that was so full of fantasy. We wanted to root the human part of it in something architecturally very convincing. And it also allowed us to do things like filling the library with books that our characters and our actors liked. So everything in that house was sort of owned. It was part of giving the Fowl family part of the story as much sort of under the skin believability and genuineness as possible. So it was another character in the movie that we wanted to portray in as great a detail as the actual acting performances themselves.
Hey, stay with me for more on Disney movies. Now, 2020 is going to be a big year with the following releases. Onward on March 6, Mulan on March 27, Artemis Fowl on May 29, Soul on June 19, Jungle Cruise July 24, The One and Only Ivan on August 14, Ron's Gone Wrong November 8, Raya and the Last Dragon November 25, and Cruella on December 23. Whew. Now, which one are you most excited for? Let me know in the comments below.